Hi friends, Chandrasekhar again. This time we are going to talk about the 8th bhava. As we have seen, bhava represents everything, and we begin with Kala Purusha as we have done in all our lectures. And so the 8th bhava primarily is the anal area and sexual organs of the Kala Purusha. It is also known, as we have seen, as Guhya, that which is hidden, that which is difficult to understand. So, as we go ahead, of course, for human, males, it will be the penile area and the anus, and female, the vaginal area, and again the anus, of course. So, that is as far as the human body is concerned. Now, what we are going to look at is what other things it represents. The 8th bhava is generally called as Mrityu bhava, the bhava of death, but that is a wrong definition. As a matter of fact, its name is Ayush bhava, the bhava of life. That is why when there is harm to the 8th bhava, then we say that there will be a possibility of death or some suffering or something. It is also known as the vyadhi bhava, the bhava for vyadhi. The vyadhi is a slightly concept, complex concept, in the sense that 6th bhava is diseases, but these diseases are generally those which are transient, and most of them, some of them are self-invited, some arise because there has been a regular neglect of that disease for a long time. So most of the part of that disease also has a component of the Jataka's own contribution to it, by the either commission or omission, whatever. Whereas here it is Vyadhi, and Vyadhi is something which is of a longer duration. And I would say that is something which is basically a constitutional defect of the Jataka, that which he has brought from the previous life. That means you can call it hereditary. I would not call it exactly hereditary, but I would say it is a constitutional defect. Like somebody has piles, so see, the walls are thin, and so there is problem, and so the walls expand, and then you have the either the bleeding piles or protruding piles and all those things, and you will note that they are all in that anal area. For a male, it could also be a problem to do with prostates. For women, it could be many a times, you know, the problem in uterus, and on different levels it will be there. Okay, so this is Vyadhi. This is a constitution. That Jataka has a constitution which has the potential of something happening in that area, which may be good or bad depending on whether the planets are aspecting it. And again, even within the planets, every planet has his own disease. Even the what we call the benefics are not free of diseases. Jupiter is connected with generally diseases connected with sugar, which we can call diabetes, which could be inherited, or gulma, something which is growth, and so on. Which we will sometime talk if we get time to talk about diseases and how to try to focus and understand what could be the diseases that a Jataka has undergone. But let us not diverge from the subject. It also represents everything hidden, so it also represents research, knowledge which is not easily understood. So 8th bhava can also indicate research, deep research. 8th bhava is also the legacy. It is a bhava of legacy, what you get from father, because it is 12 to the 9. So expenditure to the father is your profit in a way, because 8th bhava is directly opposite the 2nd bhava, which, as we have seen, is bhava of sanchita dhan, the acquired and accumulated wealth, which also includes the property or monetary benefits or whatever you get as a result of inheritance from the father. It is also said to be the fear of enemy. Now, why fear of enemy is something which would be the question that might arise in mind of an astrologer. See, we have already seen that 6th bhava is the bhava of enemies, the shatru bhava, the ripusthana we call it. Now here, naturally being 3rd from the 6th, it is valor of the your enemy. So when enemy is valorous, you naturally, if you are prudent, you are naturally afraid of his strength. So that is valor of the enemy. It is also wealth of your spouse because it is second from the seventh bhava. And but the primarily it is Ayush bhava. It is bhava of life. So fortification of that bhava or the bhava lord would indicate a longer life, less troubles. Damage there would indicate many troubles, including suppose Mars is connected with it, it could also indicate that person having accidents without any reason, sometimes without his own contribution. If Mars is connected with the sixth, then the accidents would be part of the blame would be of that Jataka himself. That is all created out of his own mistakes or let us say contributory negligence. Whereas in eighth bhava, if you are standing below a tree, a branch may fall on your head where you have no control. Bari, that of course that you did not understand that it is a weak branch. But primarily it is whether you are contributing to it or not, that can happen to you. And so you have to be careful about it, not afraid of it, because that doesn't any way serve the purpose. And that is not the reason of astrology. Astrology is about showing you the light at the end of the tunnel. And so very important thing which is generally missed is the eighth bhava is also bhava of transformation. Now why? See, in Hindu sciences, one thing is certain, you die and you are born again as a new baby. In some other body your soul will enter. Most of the people say it is human body. No, it can be anybody, because there are instances of kings being born as snakes because they did something wrong and so on and so forth. So let us not go into that part of it. That has more to do with the religious part of and spiritual side of it, because even those words of being snake or whatever have their own different connotations. And this is neither the forum nor am I the authority to talk about it. And so it is the bhava of transformation. Why? Because without death, there cannot be a birth. So you will find that powerful malefics aspecting the eighth bhava can also indicate end of something old and beginning of something new. Subject to, of course, the dasha supporting and there being a potential in the chart to achieve that. But overall, and it is usually Saturn's aspect which generally can give a change of direction to a person's life or career or behavior pattern, and so that has to be understood. So never be afraid because it is called bhava of death. No, it is not. It is bhava of life. That is why Saturn is its karaka, and Saturn is also known as Ayush karaka. He is giver of life, not taker of life. Why? Because Saturn rules over prana, the breath that we take inside, that we inhale. And without breath, you are dead anyway. I mean, in ancient times, that is what they used to do. If somebody is dead, they would hold a thread against his nostrils to find out whether the breath is going on or not. And if it has stopped, then he was declared to be dead. I mean, that is not very long ago. Maybe 100, 200 years back, that was the practice. Maybe 300 years back. So we have to understand that. So Shani is karaka for that. And again, that is a bhava which will again give life to the oft repeated phrase of karaka bhavanashaya. Because Saturn being karaka for the earth, when placed in earth, generally gives long life, not less life. He gives long life. And if we really want to go into the depth of why he does it, let us put it this way. That is because he, of course, as we have seen, that is a bhava which can indicate the tendency or the weakness of a constitution in particular area. And Saturn rules over breath as well as the arthritis. Vata, they call it. Vata has to do with air, but it has to do with diseases of joints. If Mars is there, then swelling and redness will be there, but that is a different subject. So what happens is from there he aspects the second house and the 10th house. And so you will see that such people sometimes have breathing difficulties and sometimes arthritis. And if you have observed, of course this is not stated specifically, but you have to understand Saturn is also karaka for dukkha, the sorrow. And when he is there, you will find people either having some problem with breathing problem like asthmatics or arthritic problem. And if you are observed, if you are a keen observer, and I always think that astrologers should observe other things besides only reading the science, otherwise they will never be able to apply the science to what is happening, or what they tell may not happen on ground, and then the science gets a bad name. So as I was saying, if diseases of Saturn are there, you find those people are generally long lived. You generally see asthmatic living long, and the arthritic patients living long, because if he is a karaka for dukkha, sorrow, karaka means one who causes something to be done, then for you to receive the dukkha, you have to be alive. And that is when he sits in the Ayush Karaksana. But he gives long life is certain, because it is not necessary every time Saturn is in the 8th house, so that person will have severe arthritic problem or, you know, breathing problem, because maybe some benefit like Jupiter will be aspecting it, or aspecting the 2nd house or the 10th house and reducing it to a great extent. 8th bhava is also called as the Durga, the fort. So, because fort is always guarded, and these are the guhya areas, you know, the things you cannot see, you always guard them. I mean, as we have seen earlier, sometime I was talking about, you know, how when we were talking about the Kalapurusha and his body, the genital area is always protected. Even animals protect it when fighting. If you are marked, I mean, if you are an animal lover, you will understand what happens. And so even nature protects it. And that is why in tropics, the animals, if higher the temperature, the height of animal is more. And this is, of course, more to do with the evolution theory. So rather theory, I would not say theory, the practical evolution as we see. We see elephants taller with larger ears in Africa, whereas in India, with less intensity, you will see them having smaller ears and then not as tall. So that genital area goes up to protect itself. So that 8th house and genitals has to do many things. And so it is really wonderful how the sages decided that this is the genital of the Jataka. So this is 8th house. It is house of unexpected also. Why unexpected? Because it is house of legacy. It is house of research. It is house of occult knowledge. All these things come unexpected to you. I mean, your father may be old, but you don't know when he is going to die and whether he has left you something or has not left you something. Especially if it is a self-owned property, he can give it to anybody. So when you get it, it is unexpected for you. Result of research, when they occur, they are unexpected for you. Though you have worked on it, it is not out of blue that anything comes. Even the unexpected has, you have done something about it. Always remember that. And when people say unexpected, that means at that point of time when you get that thing, it is unexpected for you. You must have done something, somebody knows you and he gives a call. So earth is also house of unexpected. It has a direct relation with the 2nd house. So 2-8 combination has always to be understood as a pair. And so sometimes in Bandhana Yoga, it is said that equal number of planets in 2nd and 8th can cause Bandhana, some bondage. It need not be physical bondage, it can be any bondage. Because that is a place which is protected. And so with malefic, it could also be actual bondage, even going to jail. So I hope you have understood the concept of the 8th bhava. And why it is house of transformation? Because unless something dies, nothing is born again. And that is again why it is called as the Ayush Bhava, the Bhava of life. And if you have understood the functional benefic nature, even there it is said, Parashara says that 8th Bhava is the Ayush Bhava. And even the 3rd Bhava, being 8th from 8th, which is a Bhavad Bhava principle which we will discuss sometime, is also Ayush Bhava, and that is why 12th from it. That is the 7th Bhava and the 2nd Bhava are called the Maraka Bhavas. Their lords have ability to finish life because that is expenditure. No? 12th from any Bhava is expenditure. So if this is life, then expenditure of life is obviously nothing but death. and that is why they are nominated as the primary Marakas, the powerful Marakas, the planets who have ability to inflict death in its own dasha, subject to gochar and other things being Marakas. So whenever I say something, always understand it is dependent on the basic natal chart, which shows the potential, the dashas, the period of influence of certain planets at certain point of time, and the transits. When all three converge, then you get something actually happening on ground that must be understood by an astrologer. Otherwise, people have a habit of saying in this dasha this will happen, it doesn't happen, and then they get perturbed why it is not happening, and so on. So I would recommend that people who want to learn timing of the event, they might like to read Raghu Parashari, which is an elaboration of what Parashara has already said. No shloka barring the first three are different from Parashari. It is focused on the how dashas manifest and what happens in what dasha, how it happens till the lowest level, though it doesn't talk about the lowest level, it only talks about the Mahadasha and Antardasha. But as I was telling, in Sanskrit, whenever something is said, rest of the things you have to understand. That was a language of brevity, and everything had to be remembered. So you carried everything in your brain, and not only Jyotisha, there were 100 subjects which were there besides Vedas and the Vyakaranas and different things, and all those used to be carried in the head. So brevity, saying one thing to mean 20 things simultaneously, as we have seen in the earth house, whatever is guarded, whatever is not seen, everything goes to the earth house. So it is also called as a Randrasthana, the place of fissure. See, in earth, if there is a fissure, then that is also known as the earth bhava. You can also look at Valmika, that is the residence of Rahu, ant hills, can also be seen by the earth bhava, because that is somewhere where you cannot see what is inside. That is why research also comes there. Even occult knowledge, or rather I would not say occult knowledge, though people are fond of saying occult, I would say ancient knowledge of any form, also comes to the earth bhava, because this is what you get from the ancients. See, father's legacy, whatever comes from the earlier generation, because father also has his legacy from his father, so whatever comes from old time, ancient times, is all represented by the earth bhava, and how we interpret it is something that we will see sometimes when, if you know, everybody likes it, my talks, then maybe sometime I will talk about that too, how to look at all those things simultaneously. And so, my dear friends, as usual, the lecture is going on. I see it is about 18 minutes, and as you can see, I have not been yet able to remove the green background. I hope you like it. And so, see you again at the next lecture on the ninth bhava, and I will try to upload one lecture every week, and if I am not able to do sometimes, I am sure you will bear with me and go on giving me your comments, your suggestions on the YouTube channel. You can also look at other things on my website www.jyotishteachings.com. I have written a book called Vedic Astrology Demystified, which goes into more in depth of what was astrology and how we, rather I interpret it. And I have also written books on Raghu Parashari. But you can read any standard classic book, and whatever I have said is nothing but my interpretation of what has already been said. So my friends, bye again, and see you at the next lecture. Thank you.